in order to ensure the security and continuing stability, the Republic will be reorganized into the First Galactic Empire for a safe and secure society.
This is how liberty dies, with thunderous applause.
If you're ready to stand on the line, if you're ready to fight back and serve it to the criminals trying to enslave you and steal your wealth through monetary creation and exorbitant taxation, you're in the right place. Welcome back to another edition of the Prepper Recon Podcast.
Our individual first aid kits are now on sale. They're Molly-compatible pouches in Coyote, ACU, OD, or Black. They're equipped with an Israeli battle dressing, quick clot, TK4 tourniquet, suture kit, and lots of extras. It's perfect for your car, bug-out bag, or home first aid kit. Go to the PrepperRecon.com homepage and click on the IFAC store tab at the top of the page. They're on sale for $89, and that includes shipping. This kit could save your life.
I've personally been buying gold and silver from JM Bullion for over 2 years. They offer the best prices over spot that I can find, and I've never had a problem with an order. If you're looking to trade in some of your fiat paper for real money, check out jmbullion.com today. Today's guest is Mack Worley. Mack is the host of On the Move, which airs live over at Blog Talk Radio, and it's also available on demand at onthemoveshow.com. Mack, welcome back to the show.
Hey, thanks for having me again, Mark.
Oh, absolutely. It's always always a pleasure to have you on. Now, because the holidays are so busy, I'm doing a little pre-recording, so I'll make sure I have a few good shows for folks during the month of December. But as we are recording this, Ferguson, Missouri is burning to the ground. There were over 25 structural fires last night, and firefighters couldn't even get to them to put the fires out because of gunshots. There's pictures of entire parking lots of cars burning, and it's just an absolute mess. I'm sure you've been following this as well, right?
Absolutely. This is madness. People are out there right now. They're destroying their own communities. And, you know, the thing is, I liken this to the Occupy Wall Street movement. You know, people are out there and they're angry, you know, and a lot of people are rightfully so angry, but not about what they're angry about right now. And some people can't even articulate what they're angry about. So you have these people that are destroying local businesses and their own community in an attempt to get back at police or the government. And my whole thought process on this, I just can't understand their logic in this. Do they really think that the police and the government are going to lose any sleep over them destroying and looting their own community?
Yeah, I don't think so. And this looks like it's been handled wrong just basically from the beginning. One thing I think that would be helpful, I mean, it started the conversation about officers wearing personal cameras to basically, just like you have in the patrol cars, so that when things happen, and because police officers are often involved in situations where they do have to take a life legitimately, I think it's really not a bad idea for them to have cameras that's going to prove that what they did was the right thing to do, or if they were in error, it's going to prove that. What do you think about officers wearing cameras?
This is actually something I've talked about pretty substantially on my show in the past. For me, I'm a big fan of accountability. I love the fact of people recording civil servants. The camera doesn't tell any lies. It only shows what is an actual account of what happened. The issue that I have is when cameras are everywhere, and they no longer are being turned on the people who are serving us, but they're being turned on us. And that's where I have an issue. So as far as a body camera on a police officer, I don't have any issue with that. I think it's just as fine as them having a dash cam. Where I do have a problem is when they can turn it on and off as they please. And then if they are the ones that have access to the video recordings, I want that off site somewhere where they can't access it or tamper with it.
Yeah, and I think that there's several political and preparedness lessons that we can learn from Ferguson. One of the things I'm looking at is I thought it was very curious that despite the fact that the mayor had asked for the National Guard to come in, I think that maybe this is one of the times where and that's a constitutional role for a governor of a state to be able to call on his National Guard to go in and quell potentially violent situations like this. So this might be one of those instances where that would have been an appropriate use of that authority. But we didn't see it. But we've seen so many other times, like where in after the Boston bombing, we had this militarized police force going house to house, doing warrantless searches for one 19-year-old kid. And so it seems like that was such a inappropriate response to that situation. And this one time when maybe it would have been a good idea, and it wasn't used. It makes me wonder if this was something that was politically done on purpose so that they can say, okay, here's what happens when we don't bring in martial law. So, you know, if we'll let one really bad situation really escalate and have a horrific outcome like we just had in Ferguson, people are going to be more apt to just embrace it with open arms, where it's a blatant violation of our civil liberties, like what we had in after the Boston bombing, to get them to accept that. What do you think?
Well, I've had conversations on. I was talking to you before we went live here about my conversations on Twitter. So I was talking to some people who were in support of the violence, the looting, the rioting that was happening in Ferguson. They were saying, you know, the police caused this. This is a revolt. My answer to that is, you know, civil disobedience is one thing, but violence is totally different. And that right now, what we're seeing is a different in the mindset of Dr. Martin Luther King and the Black Panthers, which, by the way, are out in Ferguson right now being very militant. So I want to touch on what you were talking about, though, because the conversation I had on Twitter, you know, I was saying that nothing good is going to come from this. You can say that this is a revolt and we're out here to make change and we're doing the hard work that no one wants to do or whatever. And that's a lot of what these people are saying. But this is not true. What they are doing is falling right into the trap of exactly what you said, you know, that this is a reason for martial law. All this is going to do, civil unrest, violence, destroying property, and hurting other people, you know, vandalism, those kind of things. All it's going to be is a justification later down the road for more police force and more governmental restriction on the populace. That's it. The only way that the government knows how to handle situations like this is with violence, and then they ultimately respond by creating more laws and making it a more ubiquitous federal leviathan that has more power and more control.
And these folks that are out creating the fires, burning the torching the cars, firing off shots, how do they find the time to create all of this chaos? Don't they have to get up and go to work like you and me so they can eat? Or do you think that they're part of the welfare class? And if so, has the government created this problem by providing through welfare a lifestyle that allows plenty of free time to cause trouble?
I mean, that's definitely one possibility, and I wouldn't think that would be too far off from the truth. However, there is another concern too. We have seen in the past where people have been shipped in, bussed in to basically be instigators and troublemakers, people who will incite violence. And I would not be surprised if this situation in Ferguson was another one of those cases where people are literally getting paid to be, you know, provocateurs.
We're going to take a quick break and we'll be right back. KD Armor offers affordable body armor, including level 3 trauma plates made of AR-500 steel. They can endure multiple rounds from pistols and rifles up to 7.62 NATO. Their plates are available with Rhino Linings coatings to reduce spa. Go to katiearmor.com, that's CATIArmor.com today. And then right after the announcement came out last night that the officer wouldn't be indicted, Obama came on to give his two cents, and he said in his speech that blacks are regularly unfairly treated by police. Do you think that served to quell the violence?
Oh man, this president has done so much to damage race relations. He set us back at least 60 years. This is supposed to be the president that was going to bring us all together. You know, even if you didn't vote for him, most people can at least acknowledge the fact that, okay, yeah, it's pretty awesome that we got our first black president in office. I mean, that is a historical landmark. That is really awesome to have happen in our country. The problem is that, you know, he's looked at every situation that involved race, even in the faintest situation, as a way to divide the American people. He did it with Trayvon Martin, saying that, you know, it could have been his son. And it turns out that, you know, Trayvon Martin was on top of the person who shot him. Now I can't remember his name, but he was on top of him, you know, ground and pound, like MMA style, on this guy, and he feared for his life. And the jury decided that he didn't use any violence that was overboard in that situation. And, you know, this situation with Michael Brown, he's even saying, hey, we need to keep this on track, and not saying that we need to not be violent and be peaceful. There's nothing wrong with peaceful protesting, but peaceful protesting is not rioting.
Yeah, and I've seen plenty of evidence on YouTube that proves we have good cops and we have bad cops. I've seen you could just watch YouTube all day, and you'll see police officers choose to honor their oath to uphold the Constitution, and you'll see several that will blatantly ignore it. And there may have been a day where skin color was a major factor, but in this day and age, I think Obama's comments really sounded like race baiting to me.
We're seeing it all the time from the likes of Al Sharpton and Obama. I mean, they are out there race baiting, instigating, trying to divide us, black versus white, old versus young, man versus woman. It's happening in every issue and policy that they bring up. But you mentioned something that I've recently been trying to talk about a lot more, and it's this oath to the Constitution. Part of what I do is to educate people, and one thing that I find is very, very important to know about is checks and balances within our government, but also within our society. Our founders, they were amazingly smart people. They were massive intellectuals. And the constitutional oath that everybody coming into office working for the government has to take, they take an oath to uphold and defend the Constitution. That oath comes before all laws. So what everybody's supposed to do every step of the way who's sworn an oath to the Constitution is, before they follow an order, they're supposed to decide, is this order constitutional? Or is this law that I'm trying to make constitutional? Or if I'm a police officer, is this law that I'm trying to enforce constitutional? Everybody is supposed to be the judge of that constitutionality. And that decision making has been removed from the populace. People stopped deciding that, and they say, oh, well, you know, the Supreme Court, they'll decide it. It's not my job to decide if it's constitutional. And that is completely false. It's every single one of our jobs to decide if a law is unconstitutional or not. And if it is, it's not only our obligation to not enforce it, but it's our duty to disobey it.
And to all the police who put their lives on the line and uphold the Constitution that might be listening to the show out there, to them, first, I want to say thank you for your service. But now, with that said, I think policies of several domestic police agencies infringe on the U.S. Constitution on a regular basis. And at the head of that serpent is Obama. If he thinks there's a problem with unconstitutional treatment of citizens, he needs to look no further than the closest mirror. What's your opinion on that?
Oh, yeah. I have to agree. It seems like there is a lot of people coming up with excuses for the police officers who are overusing force. People will say, well, you know, they have a tough job, and that very well may be so. But it's no different if somebody violates a law, whether or not they have a gun and a badge, or they're just Joe Schmo, that's still a violation of law. Police and government officials in general, public servants, none of these people have any special authority or over the laws. They're all subject to the laws. This is a nation of laws, not a nation of men. So, just because they violated the law and they have this authority or power, that doesn't mean they're not subject to it.
Now, let's focus a little bit on the preparedness aspects of Ferguson. Do you have parameters in place that would determine if you would bug in or bug out in case of a widespread civil unrest in your area?
Well, it would definitely be determined on the circumstance. In a Ferguson-style situation out here, I'm living in Vancouver, Washington, and we have a lot of bridges going over rivers out here and stuff. So if I was to try to go south and I missed the boat on that and they lifted the bridge, there's not a whole lot of options that I can do to go south at that point. So my plan, typically, I'm planning on packing up and leaving at the first sign of anything, and even remotely in my neighborhood or the threat of something in my neighborhood. I'd rather just pick up and go and be outside of town and sit there and wait and decide if I should come back. Maybe I jump the gun or something, but it doesn't hurt to be overly cautious, especially when dealing with rioting and whatnot. But at the same time, I'm fully prepared to bug in any kind of scenario. I don't really like the whole idea of bugging out. I think it's what you do when a plan fails. But, personally, there are some situations that I know I would leave instantly if I found out about.
And now, let's say you had something like, let's say you lived in Ferguson. Would you have been out before the grand jury decision was announced?
Absolutely. Yeah, I would have made sure that my family and any property that I wanted to evacuate with me was at least outside of the town. I mean, I would have got a hotel, somewhere, maybe 20 miles outside of town, and just waited and see into it what was happening. But at the very minimum, I would have made sure that my family was out of there.
And if you're going to do something like that, there's expenses associated with that. You said a hotel, that's an expense. You're going to have gas. You're going to have food on the road. And for most folks, you're going to have time off of work. So is this something that you have to set aside money regularly in your budget to have some type of fund, whether it's a bug out fund or just a general emergency fund that you would be able to tap if you needed to bug out in a situation like that?
Absolutely. Personally, I have saved some money. I've put away some things. I call it squirreling stuff away, and that's what I do typically. Is I stockpile a little bit of extra cash, and it's not necessarily for emergency purposes, but for also general savings and whatnot. But the reason why I do this, it can also, everything I do for preps, it can be utilized in other ways. It's not just for an emergency. If I'm stocking food, that's food I'm also eating. I'm not letting it go to waste. So the same goes with this money. And personally, I like the idea of having physical cash as well as having a credit card that I don't really touch that often. I have one credit card that I use only for gas, and that credit card is reserved for, just in case I need to bug out. I can also swipe a card if that's available.
Yeah, I had a guest on the show probably over a year ago. And he was in New York after the towers fell, and the guy that was inside the gas station locked the doors and walked away, but he left the pumps running so that anybody that had a credit card could go up and pump gas with their credit card. So that's one of those instances where cash did somebody no good, but anybody that had a credit card was able to get gas from that particular station. I don't know if that's always going to be the norm, but it's a great case for diversification. Having some cash, having a credit card, having gold and silver in case we have a complete collapse or we have a cyber attack that takes down our banking system or whatever. I just think it's great to have different options to choose from. And you were talking about if you had to go south and the bridge was up, you were out of luck. I think it's great to have multiple paths to escape your immediate vicinity as well, to have those already mapped out and thought about in case this option's not available, to have multiple options.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And, you know, one thing you were talking about, it reminded me of something in your book. You were talking about diversification. And if I'm remembering correctly, in your American Crisis books, I believe, or
American Exit Strategy?
Yes. They were talking about how they – at one point, you know, cash was an option, and then they also had credit cards. And then eventually the paper eventually stopped being worth money. And, you know, that's actually one thing that actually inspired me to kind of diversify myself, to where, you know, in any given circumstance, you know, if the money – while you can use the money, use the money. While you can use the card, use the card. But at some point, this stuff is eventually, in a total collapse, going to be worthless. So I just wanted to – you reminded me of your book, so I just wanted to mention that.
Oh, well, thanks for the plug. I always appreciate those.
Yeah, no problem.
Now, for our new listeners, what are the basics they need to have on hand to bug in for an extended period of civil unrest?
Well, that's going to depend on how many people that they're planning on bringing with them. And here's the thing too, is operational security is such an important thing. It's commonly referred to as OPSEC. So just keep in mind that whoever you tell, not only are they part of your plan, whether or not you acknowledge that or not, but anyone else that they tell, and you can basically count all their friends and family during poo hit the fan scenario, they're going to bring everybody that they care about with them. So you may only think that it's, you know, you and your family, but you've let other people know, well, congratulations, you just picked up more people than you may have intended. So it's all going to depend. But, you know, typically, and I know you say it all the time, I'm sure, the amount of water that you need just to drink in a survival situation is about a gallon of water per day per person. You could use an additional 2 gallons per person for cleaning, dishes and hygiene and things like that. So roughly 3 gallons of water per person per day. I recommend getting roughly, you know, starting out, it's really easy to get overwhelmed. And a lot of people say start out with like 72 hours of food at a time. That's a great way to start out, 72 hour emergency. But In a really almost apocalyptic kind of scenario, 72 hours of food and water is going to go so fast that it's almost just enough to throw into a bag and take with you rather than bugging in. So I personally recommend 30 days of food starting, and you can do that really easily by getting 5 gallon buckets of, you know, beans or rice, and, you know, stockpiling some water, knowing how to shut off your water system at the street so that you can utilize your hot water heater if you have one. You can get things that line your bathtub, such as like a water bob, and you can fill that up with water. All these are very, very helpful, and these are things that I've utilized.
And it seems like society is really sort of deteriorating at a rapid clip. Do you think that the civil unrest is something that we should be preparing for actively? You think we'll have more of these types of events?
Well, if you're not preparing for it, I don't know what you're doing, because it is absolutely happening right now. I mean, you can just see what's happening in Ferguson. It's already spread to California, New York. From what I understand, it's happening down in Portland, which is literally a stone's throw away from me. There was a big protest, and I don't know if it got violent over there or not, but I heard there was a lot of gang activity last night, and I was on my way out to go to the grocery store when I heard this, and I redirected it because I wasn't going to go into Portland. I decided to do my shopping over on this side of the river because of what I was hearing. But if you're not preparing for this kind of stuff, I don't know what you're thinking, because it's obviously not something that, you know, has never happened, and it's obviously not something that never could happen. It is currently happening right now.
Yeah, it's a big threat. And Matt, you've given us a lot of good information, a lot of great stuff to think about, and you always cover so many important issues on your show. Can you tell listeners when they can tune in on Blog Talk, and also where they can go to listen to the On the Move show on demand, and how else can they connect with you?
Yes, sir. So first and foremost, I have a political talk show. It's On the Move with Mack Worley. It's on blogtalkradio.com/onthemoveshow. You can hear my show live every Sunday at 5 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. That's 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time by going to that link. You can also go to that link for the latest shows, and you can download from the archive all of my previous shows. I also have a YouTube channel that I operate. It's youtube.com/onthemoveshow, or you can get there from our website, onthemoveshow.com, and that has all of our stuff on there, the link to the talk show, link to the YouTube channel, and also a link to my blog that I update periodically here. On our YouTube channel, I do political commentary and also book reviews, and you can expect one coming up here for the Prepper Recon series that he has. I've already read two of his books, and I'm going to plow through the rest of them here pretty soon. So expect some reviews on those as well. And yeah, basically the kind of stuff that I do, I'm first and foremost an individual rights activist. So, you know, I believe in civil disobedience and nonviolent protest for individual rights. So, you know, everything that entails, and everything I'm doing, I hope to inspire others to stand up for their rights, and that's what I do basically.
Awesome. Mack, thanks so much for taking time to come on the show today.
Yes, sir. Well, thank you.
Are we living in a time of which there is more prophetic writings than of any period in history? Noah Parker, like many in the United States, has been asleep at the wheel. During his complacency, the founding precepts of America have been slowly, systematically destroyed by a conspiracy that dates back hundreds of years. The signs can no longer be ignored. Watch through the eyes of Noah Parker and his family as a global empire takes shape. Ancient writings are fulfilled, and the last days fall upon the once great United States of America. The Days of Noah. By Mark Goodwin is a fast-paced fiction thriller which looks at how modern conspiracies could play into biblical prophecy concerning end times. Buy The Days of Noah in paperback, Kindle, or audio edition at Amazon.com today.